World trade is a big business. Well, I mean, yeah, pretty much is the economy after all. And thus, situating yourself near a choke point between two major bodies of water, a la Singapore, can be a godsend to an area's local economy. However, if I were to ask most people which is the most important waterway in the world, sure, some might answer the Straits of Malacca or the South China Sea, but for most, it would probably be a toss-up between the Panama and the Suez Canals. So in this video, we are going to be focusing on the history and the construction of the Suez Canal, the bigger and also much older of the two. Like, much older. Sponsored by CuriosityStream. Click the link below to help out the channel. The Suez Canal, as it currently exists, is a 193-kilometer artificial waterway connecting the Mediterranean Sea at Port Said to the Red Sea at Port Tawfiq. This waterway connects the Atlantic and Indian Oceans in a way that doesn't require a ship heading between Europe and Asia to either go around Africa or to wait for the ice to melt in the Arctic. The canal also, unlike the Panama Canal, has no locks at all, making it much easier for some of the world's largest ships to slip right through and for the canal to be expanded, should the Egyptian government be in such a mood. This makes this little waterway between Africa and Asia one of the most revolutionary projects in the transportation world. With this canal, a ship traveling from, for example, Port Sudan to Antalya, Turkey, would only have to travel around 2,000 kilometers. Without the canal and going around Africa, this distance would be nearly 23,000 kilometers, meaning that by boat from Port Sudan, it would be a shorter distance to Samoa. So this canal is pretty damn important. The Suez Canal was first opened in 1869, or at least the Suez Canal as we know it today. You see, as tough as it may have been to build a canal at this scale, this canal was far from the first of its kind in the area, and even less so the first attempt. In fact, a canal of this sort was first attempted by Egypt in the 19th century BC, under the rule of Middle Kingdom Pharaoh Senosrit II, though do keep in mind that these records aren't exactly in the best condition, with some theorizing that it might have been under the rule of Ramses II, over 600 years later. Which, even by Egyptian standards, is a pretty big range in time. Regardless, this canal was not located in the Sinai Peninsula, as is the current one. Rather, it was a canal between the Red Sea, which at this time extended much further north, and the Nile River, logically seeing as this was the heart of Egyptian civilization itself. Later canals in the area, likely even building upon the original, were constructed over 1,000 years later, with the only functional one of these being built under Darius I of Persia. A canal was reportedly later opened by the time of the Islamic Caliphates between the Red Sea and Old Cairo, basically the pre-release version of Cairo itself. Though this canal was reportedly closed under orders from Caliph al-Mansur in the 8th century AD. That combined with the Red Sea gradually receding from what are now the Bitter Lakes, caused the canal to fade into disuse. Trade in the area was generally served more by overland caravan until after the 15th century, when Western European nations decided to start going west to try to get to East Asia, and also after the Portuguese figured out how to encircle Africa in 1488. You see, that's the thing about the Suez Canal. A canal in Egypt isn't nearly as important to the Middle East as it is to Europe. Venice became a natural loser in this arrangement, and so decided to strike a deal with the Mamluk Sultanate to build a new canal through the Sinai Peninsula. But this idea had to be shelved because of that whole Ottoman conquest of Egypt in 1517 thing. That didn't mean the Ottomans weren't interested in a Suez Canal either though. In fact, it would have been a godsend to connect the imperial core in and around Constantinople to the trade and pilgrimage routes of the Indian Ocean. I mean, keep in mind, the Ottoman Empire did hold Mecca for a long time. So, well, literal godsend. However, this project was eventually deemed too expensive and also shelved. Napoleon then came to Egypt at the end of the 18th century, and also thought building a canal here would be a pretty good idea, and so decided to survey the land. However, their calculations told them that the Red Sea was about 10 meters higher than the Mediterranean, and so they also gave up. In the following decades, with Egypt now under the Muhammad Ali dynasty, again no relation, a railway was set up between Alexandria and Suez. But this wasn't exactly good enough for global trade, so guess what they thought of? That's right, another canal! After it was found that Napoleon's surveys got the height of the seas completely wrong, the canal's biggest sponsor became Frenchman Ferdinand de Lesseps. Initially, Muhammad Ali Pasha was not interested, but de Lesseps became a longtime friend with his son Muhammad Said Pasha, who eventually granted a special zone for the canal to be built, with the Suez Canal Company established in 1858, and the land given to said company on a 99-year lease, with 75% of the profits going to the company, 15% to Egypt, and 10% to their investors. Construction broke ground in 1859 and would take 10 years and a grand total of over 1.5 million workers throughout the decade, though usually 30,000 at a time, with thousands of worker deaths due to harsh conditions and various outbreaks, mainly cholera. After the two teams met in the middle at the Bitter Lakes, a huge opening ceremony was held on the canal on the 15th of November 1869, with banquets on Ismail Pasha's yacht and blessings with both Christian and Islamic ceremonies, even including a temporary church and mosque for the event. The area, seeing virtually immediate success, was declared in the Constantinople Convention to be an international zone under British protection. This would play a pivotal part in the World Wars, and would also contribute to conflict between Britain and Egypt in the Suez Crisis. If this video gets popular enough, I'll actually do a full video on the Suez Canal's 20th century history, but for the time being, the canal became a huge source of contention between Egypt and France, Britain, and Israel. Multiple times. Regardless, the moral of the story, kids, is that you shouldn't give up on your dreams that easily. I guess. This video was brought to you by CuriosityStream. Hey, is that the new documentary streaming service I've been hearing about? CuriosityStream, the sponsor of this video? Hell yeah, it is! Wow, what documentary are you watching right now? Oh, this? Why, it's the great documentary America Before Columbus, which I would totally recommend you watch. I feel like you'd really be into that. Okay, how many amazing high-quality educational documentaries can you find there, and what are they all about? You can find thousands relating to history, culture, space, biology, politics, cuisine, and things you didn't even know you were interested in. Cool, can I try it? Don't touch my phone. Okay. But if you do want to try 1 month of it for free, you can do so by going through the link below or by going to curiositystream.com/KhAnubis and using the code KhAnubis at checkout. That'll also really help out the channel. Huh, sounds like a sweet deal. What does it cost after that? Just $2.99 a month or $19.99 for a whole year? $20 for a whole year? That's insane! Absolutely! But again, be sure to click the link below or go to curiositystream.com/KhAnubis and use the code KhAnubis at checkout. Wait, didn't we just say that? Yeah, but it got buried under a bunch of extra banners, so I wanted to remind everyone. As always, thanks for watching. I admittedly had to kind of rush this video for travel reasons, but be sure to like, share, and especially subscribe to learn something new every Sunday. Especially next week, where I will be coming to you from Rome. Oh, and please do let me know if you want a follow-up to this.